Thank you, Prabhat Kumar sir. We have as our main speaker and proponent Shri K.V. Chowdary ji. He's the Central Vigilance Commissioner. He heads the Central Vigilance Commission, which is the apex anti-corruption body of the Government of India. Shri Chowdary joined the Indian Revenue Service in 78 and rose to the highest position of the Chairman Central Board of Direct Taxes. Several of his cases are reported in Let Us Share, an official document of the Income Tax Department. As the Central Vigilance Commissioner, he has been focusing on preventive vigilance. He has launched several initiatives, including programs for reaching out to the public, including school and college students, to raise awareness about the evils of corruption and the need for ethics in public life. It is indeed a moment of pride for Indian Railways, who are listening to us live, and those present here today, that he has graced the occasion and we stand to gain from his experience and thoughts. Shri K.V. Chowdary ji.
Smat Guru Bhyo Namaha. Respected Shri Prabhat Kumar ji, my good friend and CRB, Shri Ashwini Lohani ji, friends from the railways, sitting here and sitting across, some are standing across the country. It's an honor for me. I don't know about other things. I'm telling from the bottom of my heart that Shri Lohani ji has taken not one step, a huge step ahead in organizing this one-day initiating activity. I only call this an initiating activity because, as Prabhat Kumar ji said, it's a lifelong process. You can't have an ethics lecture for the day and then wash off your hands in the evening and then go back. But the fact that the railways have decided to give it a nice name of Satyanishtha and kind of a kick it off with a mass movement, probably more than a lakh of people participating today, is something very, very unique. And the commission has been doing so many things, which I will briefly touch a little later. But across the citizenry, across the public, in the recent past, I don't mean a few days, in the recent last few years, somehow there is a feeling that the ethical values or the ethics practiced by various groups of people, they are somehow deteriorating. Well, whether there is deterioration or not, there could be debate, but there is a lot of debate on the need to make oneself aware and make this a topic which you can sit and discuss. Because there are certain topics which you are aware it is a serious problem, but you just brush it under the carpet. And you don't feel very comfortable discussing. Maybe corruption is one aspect. You don't like to discuss that. But you feel bad about it. You are concerned about it. So the movement to discuss this issue has itself set a right signal. I remember about a year back, or close to a year back, I think little less than a year back, the State Bank of India chairperson, she initiated something similar to this, not this large, but they started an ethics lecture. And as a precursor to that, they hired an ethics officer, other than my CVO, not my CVO, the ethics officer, his job is to promote this kind of a good ethical conduct, try and codify what could be the right kind of a or suggested kind of an ethics for a banking sector. We all know that some of the professional bodies, they have their ethics. There is a code of ethics for the medical profession. There is a code of ethics for the chartered accountants. Probably there is a code of ethics for the advocates. So on and so forth. And then I am not trying to define what ethics is, what rule is, what law is, then what moral is, what value is. Because for a practitioners like you and me, what we need to get is the essence, not the so much of the definition aspect of it. That the theoreticians and the professors can do it. But we are basically concerned with some kind of a good practices, and practices which do not have an objection from somebody. That's what most of the practices laid down for these professionals taught. And then when the professional association or the body gets organized, it may take the form of a mandate from that body by way of issue of a mandatory guidelines that everybody is required to follow, or it may get escalated even to a kind of a, say, an Advocates Act or a MCI Act, which lays down as a mandate, and it becomes even a rule. So probably we as government servants, we have a set of rules which are supposed to govern our conduct, whether you call it CCS conduct rules or railway employees conduct rules, All India Services conduct rules, etc., which, as Prabhat Kumarji rightly said, it prescribes what mostly you should not do, or what if you don't do, you may get into trouble. But certainly, except that a couple of gray sub-rules would say, conduct unbecoming of a government servant, no government servant shall act in a way or in such a way that his conduct is unbecoming of a government servant. Such kind of a generality. But by and large, it is not talking about what could be done by him and what needs to be done by him and what is beyond the rule. That is where the ethical aspect of it is coming into the picture. Now, I had spoken a couple of times to the CII and FICCI, who have been cooperating and coordinating with the CVC in the last couple of years on the issues relating to what we call vigilance. They call probably compliance, and how compliance is to be managed, and or what they call it, compliance management. So one of the questions I ask them is, if you put a standard question to your employees across the organization, across from Kanyakumari to Kashmir and Gujarat to Northeast, a standard question, then what is the likelihood of the answer or the solution to that simple issue being the same? Is it 80%, 40%, 30%, 95%? If you have a very high organizational culture, then there is likely to be a uniform answer. I'm not saying you need to regiment. Yes, regimentation is also required. If you decide to be in railways, you need to believe in the principles of railways. You have a liberty in the closed hall to debate and challenge your CRB and say, sir, I don't believe that this works. But once it is decided, then you are bound by it. You are no longer having an individual thing. I am not on that aspect. So what kind of a organizational ethos are we building? Is it that a railway guard, whether it is defined process, you have a very detailed manuals, he acts exactly the same way, whether in Kashmir or Kanyakumari, if the circumstances are same, or he acts differently? If he is going to act differently, and even if he has good reasons, then there's something lacking in the organization. There is something lacking in the organization, and if everybody takes a call on his own, on what he thinks is good for the organization or not so good for the organization, there is bound to be chaos. 10 well-meaning persons pulling the rope in 10 different directions, you know what happens. So if you need to govern better, if you need to provide better public service in the context of railways, then we need to have a set of agreed principles, whether you call them conduct rules or you call them an accepted set of ethical conduct or ethical behavior, of what the railway stands for. And in that process, what is my role or what is the roles at different levels? And how my individual role or my individual belief is at a conflict with the organizational belief. So this is a very important issue. A large number of occasions, you have this conflict of interest leading to various troubles. So what I was saying was, you have the conduct rules as told by Prabhat Kumarji, which is a broad set of rules which you cannot afford but to follow. But what are those set of beliefs, practices, and the desirables that the organization cherishes? Look at the banking sector, or look at some other sector which does a lot of public transaction, railways. Now, some of these O's in the banking sector today, yes, economy grew, bankers wanted to aggressively advance, all that apart. If there were a better feeling of attachment to the organization, if there were a more robust belief of some kind of a codified ethical practices, probably I won't say these would have been averted, these would have come out much earlier. If in a seat next to me, my colleague is doing something not so desirable for the organization, and I, as a colleague sitting next to him, realize that something wrong is happening there, the conduct rules doesn't require me that I report, because it's not part of my job. It is the job of either Sunil Mathur or some of his staff to do this inquiry, investigation, or intelligence to do what is what. But I happen to know because he's sitting next to me and something funny he's doing every day, whether it is ticketing or if it is railways or if it is banking, something else. And if I report that, then am I at risk? Yes, I am at risk, because the colleague of mine who knows that I have reported it, he is going to give me back something in not so desirable to me. And am I going to keep quiet? Because that's going to ruin my organization, and the organization includes me. So what is the way out for him? Have we built such kind of a strong value system? Value system, I don't mean only at home. Many of us have a very strong value system at home, but maybe we don't have such a strong value system in the office we work. Unless this is built, I think organizations cannot survive and sustain themselves, and they cannot reach some level of excellence. Like, you take, for example, one very simple thing. All of us are personally very conscious about cleanliness, personal cleanliness. Nobody would like to wear, he may not wear expensive clothes, but he doesn't like to wear dirty clothes. The same cloth, you get it washed. Two pairs of clothes we have, as school children we used to have, only two pairs of uniforms. You get them washed, or you wash them yourself and try to dry them up and then wear them every day. Yes. You try to make a better presentation of yourself. But when it comes to organizational thing, none of us were not so conscious about the absence of cleanliness or ourselves contributing to the unclean environment, till somebody had to, you know, give a call from no place other than the Lal Kila and say, look here, there's a need to bring a movement or build a movement for swachhta, cleanliness. Now, it looked very odd and awkward that somebody had to tell you that, please, you know, keep your house clean. keep your nose clean, etc., etc. But we realize from where to where we have gone. The same thing, this applies squarely to the railways. I mean, not only in the matter of cleanliness, in many other matters, like the punctuality, the cleanliness, the efficiencies, what kind of a public response we have. These are not something which are there part of our conduct rules. No conduct rules can prescribe that you shall put the, you know, the empty coffee cup or tea cup in the dustbin only. And if you start prescribing this kind of a things, I think you need volumes and volumes or GBs and GBs of data to be codified. So what kind of a organizational culture do we develop? These are all, you can use these words interchangeably, but unless we develop a culture, a ethos that I identify a person in his workplace that he cannot but be a railway employee. The way in which he is moving, the way in which he is organizing his things, the way in which he is dealing with the customer, passenger in this case, etc., he is a railway employee. So if the day we can build that kind of a system, then probably our efficiencies will automatically go up and our competencies will go up. To do that, you need to do a lot of exercise, because railways employs, I think, about 13 lakh people and many more indirectly. All these come from different kinds of backgrounds, different kinds of beliefs, different kinds of understandings, etc. To bring a common platform, to bring a common kind of a mandate to them is a Herculean task. And this cannot come on its own. All the 13 lakh people, well-meaning people, also coming together, there is a need for a string or a rope to bind all of us together. And that's what Mr. Lohani is trying to do by bringing this Satyanishtha program. Because everyone, none of us will believe or will subscribe to the view of doing something wrong or not doing something which is good. But then how is it that something public good is not happening, or something which is efficient in public service is not happening, whether it is cleanliness, whether it is punctuality, whether it is revenues, or whether it is profitabilities, etc., etc. So the process to build an organization is to build a good ethical standards. You know, I am reminded of this, not very fond of quotations, but still, one of the, I think probably Napoleon or somebody said, you give me great mothers and I will give you a great nation. Now, if you have great mothers, then you don't need Napoleon to give us a great nation. It automatically becomes. So similarly, each one of us have a great ethical standard, great commitment to work, but we need to work together, because that commitment has to be translated into a railways commitment. Each one of us are a part of that family. Coming to the commission's work, we have been doing a lot of work on the vigilance front, that is mostly the punitive vigilance front. But the preventive vigilance, as we call it, is something like similar to the Satyanishtha program, which you are doing. That is, how do we prevent these? But we are not getting into the set of ethics and code of conduct, but we are trying to look more into prescribing standard operating procedures so that people know what is it that is expected of them in any given situation, whether it's a tendering situation, whether it's a ticketing situation, whether it is a office administration situation. Try and build an SOP so that by and large, everybody knows what is expected of him, and he does that. And if he follows that, he certainly doesn't get into a trouble. So this is primarily what the preventive vigilance is doing. But this particular program of the railways, the Satyanishtha program, goes few steps ahead of that. It is not just prescribing but it is transforming the character and conduct of the person to mold him into this society in a more useful and more productive way so that we deliver better goods. So one last issue which I would like to touch, which I've already touched a little bit earlier, is the conflict, management of conflict. We have just touched upon the medical profession. A medical profession has certain ethics. As a parent, I am required to follow certain ethical standards. As a child, I have a certain responsibilities to my parents. I have certain responsibilities as a citizen. I have a certain ethical conduct expected of me. My office expects me to do something else. There could be issues of conflict in this. There are bound to be issues of conflict. And the resolution of the conflict is one of the most important things. The first of all, to recognize that there is a conflict itself is a biggest thing. Because most people don't believe that there is a conflict in such kind of situations. So that's where the SOPs, that's where the peer pressure, that's where the organizational strength will come into use. And that's what seminars like this would help. As pointed out by Sri Prabhat Kumarji, this is not a one day or one hour affair. This is just probably sowing the seed, or the seed is already with you. It is just giving a little bit of a manure and water to the sapling, so that it grows in strength to strength, and it becomes a big tree giving a lot of shade and fruits. So I congratulate Sri Lohani ji on taking this initiative, which I am sure many more will follow, because your reach is something really fantastic. I am not really sure of the current numbers of how many people railways touch per day. But if railways can bring in this kind of a revolution in the character and conduct of the people, then they are going to deal with such numbers that it has a tremendous ripple effect. It is not the Satyanishtha program of the railways for its employees alone, but it is going to transform the society at large in a big way. I wish Sri Lohani ji and each one of you all success in this program. From the commission side, in our own little way, we will always coordinate with agencies who are doing this. And our idea is ultimately better governance, better standards of integrity, and naturally, these will do more good to us. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, and wish you all the best.